to start. All right, so we are beginning our fall lecture series. And what we'll be looking at over the next 4 weeks, well, the next four sessions, every other week, is the Lord's Prayer. So this is kind of by design. So back in the spring, of course, we took a tour through the Nicene Creed. And so the method to the madness here, as it were, so this is kind of the big picture, is if you look at a traditional presentation in an Orthodox catechism, how it's typically presented is that life as an Orthodox Christian involves the themes of faith, hope, and love, and how to live those out in our lives. And then taking those in those catechisms, they'll say, well, how we talk about faith is we look at the Nicene Creed, the symbol of faith, as it's also called. So we did that piece. Looking at the hope part, usually two things are covered. First thing is the Lord's Prayer. So we're doing the next piece of that. And then the second thing is looking at the Beatitudes. Blessed are those who fill in the blank. Blessedness, what does it mean to be blessed and what that looks like? So my intention is that in the spring, I'll look at the Beatitudes. And then the last piece, love, interestingly enough, is looked at through the lens of the Ten Commandments. I think part of that is, you know, we tend to look at those and read those in terms of, you know, they tend to be thou shalt not sorts of things. So they set a boundary, but the idea is don't cross the boundary, and within the boundary, do things in love. And of course, the Ten Commandments being more fully expressed and understood, not in their Old Testament roots, but in terms of what does that mean for us as Christians. So that's kind of the big picture of what we're looking at. This fits into a bigger four-part sequence that's going to continue to play out. So as I mentioned, what we're looking at here in looking at the Lord's Prayer is this expression of Christian hope, the idea of hope. So we can start with the creed and say, well, we look through the creed to understand what we believe about God and the life in the church. So that tends to be a bit more intellectual. And of course, the sorts of things that we looked at in the series back in the spring had a lot to do with all of those different things. The idea of God being a Trinity, the idea of God, well, of Jesus Christ being one person with two natures, fully God, fully man. The nature of the church, one baptism, resurrection of the dead, kind of on the idea level. So that kind of lays out the groundwork. These are the things that we believe. But the idea that we're looking at here with the Lord's Prayer is, well, how do we act on that faith? It's kind of starting on that piece. And so the acting is, how do we relate to God? And it's through prayer. And so the Lord's Prayer is the paramount example that we're given of, well, how do we approach prayer and our relationship with God through prayer? So what exactly is prayer? As I mentioned, looking at and reciting the creed is tends to be more of this intellectual description. It's more using the mind. But the description that we're given, and this is, I pulled directly out of a traditional catechism, says that prayer is the lifting up of man's mind and heart to God, manifested by devout words. And so it's this idea of taking your whole person and offering it to God through words. So, you know, part of that is, and we'll kind of get into this in a moment, this idea of that we speak our prayer. We don't necessarily have to speak our prayer, but that's kind of the starting point and the standard place that we default from. So, that's kind of the the outline, the segue that we start with. Well, in looking at prayer, again, this is from a traditional Orthodox catechism. How we pray and what we say in our prayers, they basically fall into three categories. So one is an idea of praise. So what we are praying is praising God for who he is. So that's one type of prayer. Then the second one is thanksgiving, which is offering thanks to God for the things that he has done for us. And then the third one, of course, is petition, asking God for certain things. And so again, this language from the traditional Orthodox catechism. Man should glorify him, God, for his divine perfections. So it's just this, I know it sounds a little crass, basking in the glory of God. It's just, you are God, and there's something amazing about that. And then this traditional language, giving thanks to him, God, for his mercies. And then the last one is, ask him for what he, man, needs. So we have those ideas: praise, thanksgiving, petition. Now, often when we hear about those, and often what we see in just contemporary expressions of, I'll call it a generic Christianity, there tend to be caricatures or misguided ideas of what those mean. So often when we hear the word praise, we think of, we add the word praise band. We know there are churches that have part of their service, they'll have a band and they offer praise music, as it's called. And it's interesting, it's kind of the tenor and the direction that you will find in that is it's about stirring up the feelings of the people that are present. Do they feel good about God, as it were? And so the difficulty with those experiences of praise music and praise worship, it's about the worshiper feeling a certain way and being inspired to feel a certain way. It's not about God. We think of, a phrase, and it's a phrase at the end of the Lord's Prayer, glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, both now and ever and unto ages of ages, amen. That's entirely about God, glory to God. But there's a praise song, and you may have come across this. Our God is an awesome God. Well, our God, and so it's kind of like this thing that we have. Our God is an awesome God. It's not so much offering that to God, it's describing something we hold on to. So it's a little bit off there. So that's kind of the difference that we might see contemporary in this idea of praise as opposed to the traditional one. Praise has God as the subject. So let's turn now to thanksgiving and some of the contemporary things that we might see with prayers of thanksgiving. I haven't seen this recently, but I know that probably within a few years, a few years in the past, you might have heard this term hashtag blessed. So people that post things on social media, you can do the little hashtag with the topic or whatever, and they'll use that language. My life is wonderful because of all of these things that I have, hashtag blessed. So it's this idea that God has blessed me with things. And they tend to be the things that make us comfortable, happy, safe, or, materially, our material lifestyle is going well. Look at this pretty house I have, hashtag blessed. When it's actually what we look at, kind of the things that you see in, authentic Christian prayer about giving thanks, they're for things that help us survive, as it were, physically, emotionally, morally, spiritually. Thank you, God. We'll see this in the Lord's Prayer. Give us this day our daily bread. That's actually a petition, but there's also this thankfulness. Thank you for feeding me today. I had food today. Thank you for the roof over my head. I had shelter today. It tends to be on that level. Thank you for delivering me from this difficult circumstance, which may have harmed me physically, emotionally, you know, spiritually. It's things like that that we look at with Thanksgiving. All right, third, we'll look at petition here. And so I know that the caricature that we can see is that, and there's kind of, you know, language on this. God basically is a big cosmic vending or slot machine. If you put the right coins in and push the right button, you'll get the thing that you want. And sometimes it's kind of this feeling of there's an element of chance. If I keep putting quarters in and pulling the arm down, eventually I'll hit the jackpot and get what I want. And there are forms of Christianity that talk about, you may have heard this phrase, name it and claim it Christianity, where you can say, well, I want X amount of money in my bank account. I want to get this kind of luxury car. I want these benefits in my life. And so it's the whole thing of naming that thing and having the expectation that God will give it to you, claiming it. And it becomes this thing, kind of where it's become most rampant. You know, the example that we have is some of these folks on television, and they'll preach about this. And of course, they'll put the caveat in there, and they'll say, please send me a check for $100 so you will be blessed. This is your seed money to be blessed and receive this thing. The place that this has become the biggest phenomena is Latin America, where there's abject poverty. And so it's preying upon people in poverty and telling them, if you just pray the correct way, you'll get all of these great things. And of course, the flip side of the coin on that is, in that whole expression and approach, if you don't get those things, somehow you did it wrong and it's your fault and you're not faithful enough. And so it becomes this, you know, this guilt-inducing thing. I didn't get the big house, and I didn't get the bank account, and I didn't get the luxury car. There's something wrong with me. Very different thing. The language that we have, again, and this is similar to Thanksgiving, are the things that we need. We ask for the things that we need. And more specifically, it comes down to we ask for the things that we need for our salvation. And there are even phrases in prayers within the life of the church, about asking God for the things that are good for my salvation. And basically saying that there is a promise there that God will grant you the prayers for things that are good for your salvation. Of course, the difficulty is we're not always great with discerning what's a want and what's a need. We're very good about finding things and that are wants, but we can understand them and perceive them and explain them to ourselves in terms of needs. Well, I really need this. That's why I'm praying for it. And why am I not getting it? And sometimes the discernment in there is, I keep praying for this thing and it doesn't happen. Well, potentially, it's probably something that you don't need. It's something that you want. So that can be the difficulty there. So that's this general idea of prayer. So we've kind of worked through, where did this series come from, kind of what we're doing long-term with this and how it fits in with all of that, how we're specifically looking at the Lord's Prayer, and how the Lord's Prayer is expressive of prayer. So when I kind of was doing all this introductory material on prayer. So now we'll transition to specifically looking at the Lord's Prayer and starting on that. I'll pause a moment. I don't know if there are any questions or comments. I'm gonna hydrate for a second. So what we look at specifically in terms of the Our Father, and I'll just pause here. And I think we all pretty much know it, but I'll recite it for the purposes of what we're doing here tonight. So as we typically hear this, We'll pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So in the traditional presentation of this, it's actually broken out into 8 parts. And so we're essentially looking at 2 parts per session that we're going to look at here. So tonight, we'll look at the first 2. Our Father who art in heaven, that's the first part. That's called the invocation. It's called the thing that starts the prayer. And then the first article, hallowed be thy name. So we'll look at those 2 in depth here as we get into this. So hearing that prayer, the question is, where did that prayer come from? So this gets at the context. So when we look in the Bible, of course, when we talk about the Bible, Old Testament, all of the things that happened before Jesus, New Testament, Jesus Christ, and after. It's in the New Testament. Well, within the New Testament, we have the first 4 Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And those are the specific books that talk about the life and ministry of Jesus Christ. And so it's within the Gospels, and it's actually in 2 of the Gospels where we hear this specifically, the Gospel of Matthew and the Gospel of Luke. And they're similar. They're almost identical. So I'll do these from New King James, which is essentially what we use in our Orthodox study Bible. So how we hear this in Matthew is, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So that's Matthew's presentation of it. Luke's presentation. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us day by day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins. For we also forgive everyone who is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. So a little different in some of the phrasing there, but they are pretty much the same prayer that's being offered there. So that's where they come from. How are they being offered in those 2 contexts? And why are they being offered? So they both occur, well, Matthew's instance, this is actually at the beginning of his public ministry. So, we have in the Gospels, of course, the story of his birth. We don't really hear much after his birth until he's about 30 years of age. He's baptized by John the Baptist in the River Jordan, and the icon here on the wall here shows his baptism. Immediately after his baptism, he goes into the wilderness, 40 days, 40 nights, is tempted, and then he returns and he begins his public ministry where he teaches, he casts out demons, and he heals people who have illnesses or are possessed by demons. And so in Matthew's gospel, it follows that sequence. And then at the beginning of chapter 5, and for chapters 5, 6, and 7 of the Gospel of Matthew, he has what's essentially one of the longest teachings. So him uninterrupted teaching things in sequence. And part of that is this question of prayer. So in Matthew, in that context, it's basically to distinguish prayer from how prayer was being done at that time. And so there are examples where, actually that's a better example, I'll start there and then come back here. If we look in Luke, Gospel of Luke, You know, and this is something that we read every spring, you know, the story of the Pharisee and the tax collector, sometimes called the publican and the Pharisee. And it's this example, it's a parable of these two men that are in the temple in Jerusalem praying. I only have two ribbons, and I'm referencing three readings, so that's why I'm flipping around a little bit here. 18. Let me get this here. And it's a relatively new Bible, so the pages stick together a little bit. Here we go. So I'll read this. Also, he spoke this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. So this is a parable Jesus is offering to some religious leaders who were full of themselves, as it were. So the example he's giving to them. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee, just one of the religious leaders of that time in Jerusalem, and the other a tax collector, who was essentially an outcast and a villain in Jewish society at that time. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself. Interesting phrase there. God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I possess. And the tax collector, standing afar off, would not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man, that's the tax collector, went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. So the example we get there of the Pharisee, the religious leader, is he's not even really praying. He's reciting his resume, as it were. So he's like, thank you, God. He's not even offering thanks to God for something that God has done to him. Thank you that I'm not like these lowlifes around here. There's probably something good about that. He's an upstanding member of society. But the fact that he's calling out these people to, you know, say, well, I'm not like these guys. I'm a pretty good guy. And then just kind of reciting and saying, well, I do these things. As opposed to the sincerity of the tax collector who is speaking from his heart. I do terrible things. Have mercy on me. So that is an example. You know, the Pharisee is the example of the sort of prayer that was kind of standard at that time. Going through the motions, kind of presenting things to make yourself look good. So specifically, so if we go to Matthew, Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus presents the Lord's Prayer, he prefaces it this way. So he's calling out bad behavior again. And when you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in synagogues and on corners of the streets. Imagine that, just kind of in public. That they may be seen by men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. So is the motivation to be seen? You know, I think today we call something like that virtue signaling. I think it's like, you know, spiritually great signaling. But when you pray, go into your room. When you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in the secret place, and your Father will see in secret, will reward you openly. And when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathens do. So it's not you're doing incantations that you're offering over and over again here. For they think that they will be heard for their many words. Again, it's kind of that slot machine thing. If I put the right coins in, and if I put enough coins in, God will hear me. Therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask him. And then he proceeds, in this manner, therefore, pray. And he offers the Lord's Prayer. So that's one thing. It's the corrective for how people were praying at that time and saying, what is an authentic way to pray to God and what's the orientation on that? Now in Luke, the context is different. Now it came to pass as he was praying in a certain place, this is Jesus, when he ceased, that one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. So he said to them, when you pray, say, and he offered the Lord's Prayer. So it's this circumstance. As I said, early on in Jesus' ministry, he's seen as someone who has something to say, and he does these healings. And so people are, you know, coming around him as a religious leader. You know, when they mention John, and that means John the Baptist. So of course, if you look at those narratives, John the Baptist prepared for Jesus to come. And so John, remember, he said, repent, the kingdom is at hand, be baptized to be forgiven for your sins. And so he had a following, and he had disciples, and he taught them how to pray. And of course, he understood, I'm just here to open the door and pave the way, but it's actually Jesus Christ that we're waiting for. And when Jesus arrived, he said, well, he must increase, Jesus Christ, but I must decrease. He understood that he was stepping into the background. So the disciples of Jesus had some of them had that background of being followers of John's. They said, well, we were taught to pray by John, but you're kind of the replacement that we were waiting for. How am I supposed to pray? So this is a model, and it's kind of the paramount model that we're given for Christian prayer. And of course, all of our other prayer builds from this. So, yeah, and an interesting highlight here. Sometimes we have the sense that we intuitively know how to pray. But we hear in this disciple, teach us how to pray. So we might feel and we might have this inclination towards prayer. But in terms of how to do it, there does need to be some instruction. So that's part of the idea with the Lord's Prayer. Okay, we'll transition now and start looking at those two pieces of the Lord's Prayer that we have scheduled for tonight. Our Father who art in heaven, and hallowed be thy name. And there are two parts in this invocation. Our Father who art in heaven. I'm really parsing this out here. What's interesting is that phrase, our Father, and what's being said here. What's being expressed and what Jesus Christ expressed in this prayer is that we have a closer, more intimate relationship with God than previously. So if you look in the Old Testament, all of the writings before Jesus Christ, God is never referred to as our Father. It's not a familial relationship. The analogy that we have, of course, there's this very otherly notion of who God is. God is kind of outside all of this and is coming into the lives of the Hebrews/Jewish people. And the relationship is much like, I am an emperor, and you're kind of a small vassal kingdom here, and I'm entering a covenant with you. If you notice in the stories of various covenants that we have, so we can talk about, you know, Noah or Moses or Abraham, they're always initiated by God. It's not as if the people somehow are initiating this with God. But that's the character. It's, I'm basically a conquering emperor, and you are subject to me. You still get to maintain who you are and kind of your self-rule as a small sub-kingdom, but I'm the one that's truly in charge here. And that's the relationship that's presented there. So you can imagine part of the scandal in what Jesus Christ said, and part of the scandal that led to his crucifixion, was saying, well, my Father in heaven, saying that he had a familial relationship with God the Father, and that it wasn't just he's someone distant, but is our Father. And of course, that phrase, the Son of God. Do you claim to be the Son of God? He's like, well, you've said it. He doesn't ever deny it. But he basically says, well, you said it, so I guess that's the case, and kind of goes along with it. So for us to pray that, it does become this thing where prior to that, it was very much this relationship. We're dealing with this distant royal God, and we are kind of subject, kind of down here sort of thing. And that's the only relationship that we have. But now we can refer to him as our Father. So we get this language that we're given. So it's this idea of, of course, after Jesus Christ's crucifixion, death, resurrection, and ascension, we have this new thing, the church, which Jesus Christ left. And that when we enter the church, we are adopted sons and daughters of God the Father. So that's why we can pray that prayer. So we have that more intimate relationship with God as our adopted Father, as it were. Now, there's a caveat here, and I will talk about this a little bit more in the second part when we talk about hallowed be thy name. This does not negate what we heard in the Old Testament, this image of God the Father as a king, that royal stature. That's still there. But our relationship is closer than what it was within Christianity. So that's our Father. We describe God, our Father, who art in heaven. That's describing God the Father as separate from us. And this looks at what was common in the ancient world. Is this idea that God, or gods, probably more in the case of gods, were things all around you? You know, that one of the issues that the early church had was they wouldn't worship the Roman emperor. There was an understanding in the Roman Empire that the emperor was a god. So whoever that was sitting on that throne in Rome was a god, and you made offerings to a statue that represented that God. That was part of being a good Roman citizen. Of course, the church is like, well, no. Our Father who art in heaven, our God is separate from that. And this is really, really also part of what we parse out when we read the story of Genesis, the very beginning of the Bible, the creation of the world. We kind of get caught in, we kind of have this science versus faith thing, and we get all stuck on, is it, literally talking about 7 days of how this process worked of the world being created. And the truer reading of that and the more careful reading and the point of that is to basically go through this catalog. It's an apologetic task. First, God, created the things out there. He created, the stars, he created the sun, he created the moon. He created trees, he created animals, he created things in the ocean. And what is basically happening there is the creation story is going through this list of what everybody else around them worshiped. And it's making this point. Oh, you worship the sun? Well, my God created that. It's actually a creation. My God is above that. Oh, you worship the moon? Well, my God created that. My God's more important than your God. And all of this stuff that you people worship, it's subsumed under my God. That's kind of the point of the Genesis story. So this is just playing that out as well. So for those ancient peoples looking for all of these different things and praying to them as gods of some sort in the natural world. I know it's kind of hard for us to process because we live in a world that is based on material. We believe in physical substance, and we don't really believe in much outside of that. But the difficulty is that, we can talk about a scientific or a philosophical materialism, saying things are just physical substance. But we also talk about materialism in terms of a value. And so it is this thing of money, possessions, professional success, power, physical gratification, just what we do with stuff and how much stuff we have. And we make idols out of those. Those become things that we say, well, that we don't say it that way because it's just material stuff. There's nothing else beyond that. There are no ghosts running the system here. There's no God. That's kind of the extreme. Or if you do believe in God, it's just some benign thing out there and doesn't really interact with me other than when there's a crisis and I need help. But it still comes down to this thing. Well, the possessions, what you do in your life, what you do in the world, your physical gratification, those are all things that God created, and he's separate. So it's defining that. We do that as an invocation to say, okay, we're going to pray now, and we are going to have this conversation, as I mentioned in the beginning, where we lift our mind and our heart to God. So part of that is by invoking God. God's our Father. We have a relationship with him. And he's in heaven. He's separate from the world that we're in. There's something special about that. That points us at this, what's called in the Catechism Article 1, which is the phrase, "Hallowed be thy name." Hallowed is kind of an old-timey term. And we're like, what does hallowed mean? And what we might hear is Halloween. Well, where does the word Halloween come from? This has to do with Western Christianity. So Halloween is October 31st. But in traditional Western Christianity, if you look on the calendar, November 1st is All Saints Day. All of the saints of the church are commemorated. And so the older language is All Hallows' Eve. So it's anticipating this All Saints Day. Probably the better word that we look at is, instead of hallowed, holy. So a way of thinking of this is, holy be thy name. It's recognizing that speaking of God, invoking God, and our relationship with God involves a level of holiness. And holiness kind of ties in with what we're seeing. Holiness means separate. Holiness means it's not everyday. It's not pedestrian. And where we see that tangibly in the life of the church, of course, is how we have the church space set up. So, of course, we have the icon screen here, the altar, which we serve, where I serve on Sunday. I always stand in the front. And for those who haven't been to an Orthodox service, you can kind of see I have a little black mat here. It's because I'm getting old and it's hard to stand for a long period of time. So it's one of those padded mats so I can stand there. I stand there, but I face that way. I know some people make a joke and they're like, why do you do that? We can't see you. It's like you're driving the bus and we're along for the ride. I mean, there's a level of truth to that, but the more correct way to think of it is we talk about the altar, of course, as an altar, as a special thing that's separate and dedicated. It's not like I come in here during the week and, you know, bring a sack lunch and go up here and say, well, I'm going to eat lunch here today, and just kind of put out, you know, my ham sandwich and a drink and chips. And this is only used for church services. And what we have, and this was actually a conversation we had with our bishop who was visiting this past weekend, there was desire expressed in our community about having a permanent altar. This is a temporary altar that we've just used forever. But, you know, there's a whole thing of you have a permanent altar. It's blessed by the bishop. They put relics of saints inside of it. The names of all the founding members are put inside of it as a memorial. So there's a whole thing about that. And the bishop's response was, we can't do that because this is not going to be the permanent church. The expectation is that we build a permanent church building entirely by Orthodox Church's design. You know, we bought this building and moved in, and this is serviceable as an Orthodox church. But the bishop's expectation is that we will build a separate church. And it's not just blessing a table, but it's blessing the entire space. So it's the entire church, but also the entire area up here. So that's a holy item, even in its temporary sense. And this is a holy place. A conversation that I have with our families with young children is, of course, the kids like to come in here and run around. And I say, well, I make the point, you should not be running around because this is not just a room with chairs in it. This place is different than what's on the other side of those doors. And we're in a holy place. We're in the presence of God. The tower thing here on the altar. Within that, I reserve the sacrament. The body and blood of Christ are up there right now. It's always up there. Pre-sanctified. You know, so if there are people who are sick and need communion, I can come to the church and get that and take it to them. But it's always there. So it's holy in here. And there's even that distinction. It's more holy up here. You can look at Old Testament and the temple, and you have different courts and places, and then you have the Holy of Holies. This is kind of the New Testament version of that. So not anyone can go up there. Basically, they need a blessing from me to go up there. And it's while I'm up there. And it's to assist me while I'm up there. So we have, you know, boys that will come and help with the service. And you'll see when they come in, I have to bless them, and then they serve with me, and it's just for that particular service. So it's this recognition that God, being in God's presence, involves a level of holiness. There's otherness involved there. And this kind of gets back to what I was saying, the separateness of God, and the sense of, you know, and the language that we see more so in the Old Testament, but it's still present there. He's a king. He rules. And sometimes there's this language of, you know, and we hear these terms to some extent, the wrath of God, the fear of God, being fearful of God. And people will say, well, why do we say that? Why do we say that we're afraid of God? I say, think of it. You were created. He's the creator. Everything around you was created. And he's in charge of all of that stuff around you. You don't control all of that stuff around you. You don't make the world spin. You don't make it go around the sun. You don't control how, you know, atoms stick together or don't stick together. That's all God's work. We have a relationship with him. But in terms of his power and ability, he's here and we're here. Isn't that a scary thought? And it's not that he's out to get us. It's just that difference. You know, I think we could think in terms of just kind of a contemporary societal thing that's very approachable for us. We probably have our heroes of culture, a favorite sports figure. It might be, you know, a politician or a president. You know, it might be a rock star. And we think, if I ever met that person in person, I would be awestruck in the sense that my jaw would drop and I'm worried I'd say the wrong thing and I'd be very self-deprecating. We do that with important people, but they're people like us. So imagine God is someone wholly other, the creator of everything, and us having a relationship. We would be awestruck by that. And that's kind of the picture that we see in a lot of the stories of the Old Testament. And you know, some of the encounters that we have. You know, we hear the stories of Moses going up on the mountain, separate from everyone else, to be with God. And that when he came down, his hair was white and his face shone. It's kind of like he got, you know, zapped with this light and was just radiating this light. Something completely different from what anyone ever experiences outside of that. So that's this picture we have. Hallowed be thy name. The holiness of God. And this is why we get into, we'll look at this in one of the other series when I get to the series on the Ten Commandments, probably this time next year. That whole thing about not using the Lord's name in vain. Well, if he's the creator, you're the creation, you recognize his power and authority and the fact that he's very different from who you are, why would you trivialize or minimalize how you speak about him? And so there's that whole dynamic there. So that's the element of holiness there. So, in terms of my notes, I've gotten to the end of my notes. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. So our next session, we'll look at the ideas. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So, that all being said, I open the floor to questions. There's always questions. This is the fun part. I enjoy the question part. Michael.
Sure. Since there was two apostles who wrote the Lord's Prayer,
mm-hmm.
is there anything in history, any of your readings, who should be given credit for saying it the first time, writing it the first time, that these apostles copied it? I assume they both didn't say the same thing, you know, separately and come up with it, I don't think. So I'm just curious to give credit to whoever wrote it.
So it would be, I know that there is some conversation there about that. I think the one caveat that we have to keep in mind when we do talk about these writings, the standards and intentions of writers in the first century, very different from ours. So the example of, do we give the proper citation and who are we citing, that's a contemporary concern. And so our tendency is to take it within the church very much at face value. So, you know, Jesus did the Sermon on the Mount. It was early in his public ministry. So he offered it there. Matthew wrote it down. And then in Luke, I mean, what I've seen, it says, well, this context is he's praying, he's meeting with the disciples. It's essentially the same prayer. And it's within that context. So it might be teaching the same thing again for the benefit of those who didn't hear it the first time. Mm-hmm. And then there's also another layer of what we have with the prayer. And I did play with this a little bit, looking at different Bible translations and looking at this psalm. And I know this comes up with some of the parts of the prayer further down. Some of the variation has to do with how it was translated and kind of what's in the original manuscripts and kind of what the translators did there and what they were trying to present. So that's a longish answer, but basically the short is we take it at face value. Yeah. Matthew heard it in this context, wrote it down. Yeah. Luke heard it in this context and wrote it down.
Yeah, I hear that, but what surprised me throughout your entire presentation Not one time did you say, Jesus said this.
So that's on me.
I know. Well, I just want to make sure it was right. That's on me. That's right.
Yeah.
Okay. That's all.
Yeah. And so kind of the overarching idea here is, kind of giving, the reasons and rationales and all of that. But at the heart of that, it's, well, why did Jesus present this?
Right.
So kind of underlying is the assumption Jesus did present this and did present it as the model to work from. So, okay. Other questions or comments? Yes.
Father, and for everyone here, I just wanted to introduce myself. My name is James Riley. I'm a friend of Jacob Shipkovich, who just moved here, interested in joining the congregation. We had a mutual friend who introduced us to Orthodoxy.
Mm-hmm.
I was actually confirmed Lutheran, Father,
mm-hmm.
if I say that correctly. There was one thing that you said, many things resonated with me. I am familiar with the song, Our God is an Awesome God.
Yeah.
And when you kind of introduced that part of, why do you say our God, right? That it almost sounded like, don't compare, there's one God, right? At least that's how I took away what you said there. My question is, I was kind of sitting on that thought up until then we got to the first sentence of the Lord's Prayer, which says, Our Father.
Mm-hmm.
Do you just have any thoughts on that? Like, to your point earlier on this,
yeah,
one, our God is an awesome God, right? If you maybe just rehash that part. It seemed like,
yeah,
that the word our, it seems like for that song, the word our isn't even necessary, right? It's God.
Yeah. And so that, I think what I'm hanging my hat on there with that, our God is an awesome God, really is that entire phrase. And saying, what's the importance and what's being focused on in that? Our God is an awesome God. It seems to be saying more about, is that basically hanging on to, well, our God is an awesome God. And it's talking more about our, like an expression that
what we own.
What we own.
Yeah.
But if you look in here, our Father who art in heaven. So it is saying that. It's our Father, but he's in heaven. And it's not really looking at this idea of, well, he's awesome or great. And of course, the context. When is that song, Our God is an Awesome God, sung? It's in a worship service, but often the character of that, again, going back to kind of this idea of what we heard. Worship's one thing. And worship can be this thing where it is about stirring up feeling, as opposed to worship, and kind of how we parse, it's an oldish term too, worth, it's kind of the word worth-ship, bestowing worth upon something that is of value. And so again, in worship, the point is pointing at God. So, if it said God is an awesome God, that's probably a better way of writing it. And then how it's used probably could be done differently. So that's kind of the point I was making. Hope that helps.
Absolutely. Thank you.
All right. Other thoughts, questions?
Just a comment. Mm-hmm. I've been wasting a lot of time trolling on Facebook.
Well, that's your first mistake.
Yes. I just try to stay away, but it's amazing how much time you can waste. But I ran across this one site, Orthodox Women, and I was really amazed because someone was talking about that they were watching, I guess they're a new convert, they were watching a priest do a sermon online, and that priest had said, oh, you should not pray for people who are not Orthodox. And I was pulled my hair out when I heard that, because this woman was saying, they really upset her because she has either stepchildren or half children,
mm-hmm,
or whatever, and she has her own children, and she says, that means I shouldn't pray for the stepchildren. I thought, that's a terrible thing to even think about. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, it's,
should we not? I mean, I've never heard of not praying for someone, even though they may not be Orthodox. Because there are a lot of people who need help,
so
need to pray for them.
let's do a I'll call it a reverse slippery slope.
Sure.
I know that something that can be a stumbling block for people when we talk about the Orthodox Church. We saw this some when we were last spring when we talked about the Nicene Creed. Mm-hmm. I'm probably opening a can of worms here, but we'll go with it. So the language that we have is, this is the New Testament church, this is the original church. We can kind of go through history and kind of the
see the shoe bumps.
It's everybody left us. And so all of these other groups are elsewhere. And we're not sure what's happening in those other groups. We know we're the church. And of course saying, well, we're the church of the apostles. We go back to the New Testament, Jesus. That can be a tricky thing for people to hear. And they're like, well, what does that mean about me? But what happens when we have people that show up at the doors of our church who are not Orthodox, who have an intention of converting, who are interested in doing that? Do we pray for them? Or do we just wait until they're in the door? I can tell you, the people that show up at this church that have an interest, I pray for them. But then it gets into, okay, well, I have conversations with those people. They have siblings, they have parents, children, who may or may not become part of the church. And they have concerns about relationships with those families. Do I not pray for those people? And then we get into bigger things. We say, you know, kind of our big thing about the fall and redemption and Christ's work. It's not just about individual souls. It's about the world. And saying the world's fallen. And there are bad things that happen in the world. And aberrations and all sorts of stuff. Pain, suffering. People suffer. They may not be Orthodox Christians. They suffer. Do I not pray for people who suffer, regardless of whether or not they come to my church? That's my answer. Might be a little impassioned, but that's my answer. We pray for everything. We pray for everybody.
I've never answered on any of these because I don't want to get involved, but I was ready to pray for everybody. Even on Sundays, mm-hmm. during the liturgy, which can be served any day of the week, actually, we pray for our president, for our service people. We pray for everybody.
Yes.
And not everyone is Orthodox. Not everyone is Christian.
Yeah. And that's the thing, that at the beginning of a liturgy, that litany, in peace let us pray for the Lord, for the peace of the world, well, only this part of the world that has Orthodox churches. No, we don't pray that. As you say, President of the United States, our civil authorities, our armed forces everywhere, for those who travel.
Right.
We pray for everybody and in every circumstance. Yeah.
Just checking.
Yeah. Glad I could help. Get off Facebook. It's,
no,
it's not good.
Less. The only reason I did it to see what my children were doing, because I'd see what they were doing there before they would call me and tell me.
So, fact checking before the fact.
Right.
Or the accounting. Jacob, did you?
It's a two-part question. The word "are," is that an archaic rendition of the word "are"?
Yes.
It seems like there's a pluralism connotation when it's said in the Lord's Prayer. I just want to understand what it means in that context.
So say more about pluralism. Pluralism in what sense?
I think we talked about this the other day. In Genesis, let us create man.
Mm-hmm.
So this us, who is this us? And then it goes back, it's parallel to like this art. Who, our God who are in heaven, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why isn't it who is in heaven?
So that in part gets to an issue of translation and usage. And so how it developed, and I looked at this a little bit, there's if you go to Wikipedia and do Lord's Prayer, you know, I'm kind of doing like the church version, but if there's good information in Wikipedia on the Lord's Prayer, it will talk about translation and the sort of language that's used. So you know, the use of the term art is an archaism It is an older form of the word. And what developed in English-speaking countries is that the form that we use in our service very much models that form, the archaic form. So, so if I just look at that, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. I'm just kind of scanning through here. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. So it is using that archaism. But the thing that you will find, and this is something that really stands out for me, there are times when I'm in a not exclusively Orthodox group. And a good example. Up the street here, Bainbridge Community Church, behind it, it sounds hokey to me, but there's a cemetery, Rest Land, which is like the Bainbridge Cemetery that's been here for 150 years. And so they do a Memorial Day thing, a parade, and they have service people and, you know, 21-gun salute and Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts reading the names of all veterans who've died fighting wars from Bainbridge, and many of them buried in that cemetery. And so part of what they do is they will invite local clergy to offer a prayer, basically an invocation, a prayer at the beginning, and then a benediction, a prayer at the end. So this year they invited me, and as a part of that, I included the Lord's Prayer in the form that we say. Everyone knows it. So it's one of these, it's kind of odd, it's more of a cultural entity, that particular translation, but everyone knows it, and they stick with it. But one of the things that we see in Bible translations, especially more contemporary Bible translations, like the New King James, they modernize it. So for example, I read from this, our Father in heaven, not art, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done. And so it updates that. Now what's interesting is within the Orthodox world here in the United States, there are different Orthodox groups. Same faith, but they're different groups. And it's harder to explain that. So you have Greek Orthodox, Russian Orthodox, Antiochian Orthodox. And so within our group, Antiochian Orthodox Christians, we have a commitment to using that older form of language, not just with the Lord's Prayer, but with our liturgy. And so the prayers that we have, and it throws people, we have the thee, thy, though,